You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
And a swinging good Tuesday to all of you out there in TV land. Welcome to session number 13, Lucky 13. This is Ideas 336. You've tuned into Jazz in the Modern Era. I'm Chad Hanley, and as always, we're coming to you live from the campus of California State University, Dominguez Hills on LA 36, all of its local affiliates, and we are coming to you via the internet, both live and in delayed fashion. Stay tuned. It's great to be back with you for another hopefully exciting session of music. The usual number scrolled across your screen, 800-339-1193, remains our number into our room. I welcome your calls anytime between now and 10 p.m. when we leave the air. In addition, for those of you that like to sit at your machine on your desk or that computer in your pocket, you can send me a message and I'll be happy to respond to it. Ask dhtv@gmail.com. And again, I think all of you that are regular viewers are fully aware of the fact that we archive all of our broadcasts. And they are available via YouTube, like everything else that's on film these days, it seems. YouTube.com/CSUDHTV. Sessions 1 through 12 are available to you for those of you that would like to take a look at our past broadcasts this fall semester 2013. And tonight's session 13 will be up hopefully within 24 hours after we leave the air this evening. We kick things off in a swinging way, as I mentioned at the top, with a lady who we discussed a couple of weeks ago when my very, very special guest, the fabulous vocalist Miss Janice Mann, joined me for a look at some of the seminal vocalists in jazz. That was session 2, by the way, of the vocalists. And one of the supreme vocalists who whose legacy is so rich and continues to impact so many vocalists, Miss Shirley Horn, was featured. We shared with you a video of her at work at the Village Vanguard in New York City back in the early 1990s. And she sang a fabulous rendition of, suddenly the name of the tune has disappeared. I'll think of it in just a moment. But the manner in which she sang it was oh so Shirley Horn. Very, very slow, very, very deliberate as she accompanied herself at the piano. In this case, you hear Shirley Horn stretching out as only Shirley Horn could do. At the piano, you heard those bebop chops on a famous chestnut that all of you, I'm sure, are very familiar with. Isn't It Romantic is the tune. This is recorded. Now, those of you who are jazz fans, remember this room with a big smile on your face. How many of you remember attending any jams at the Vine Street Bar and Grill? This was recorded live at the Vine Street Bar and Grill back in 1987. And again, the tune, Isn't It Romantic? And that's the name of the date. Shirley Horn, Isn't It Romantic? Live at Vine Street. The gentleman working with Shirley Horn, Charles Abels on bass and Steve Williams on drums. Gonna throw a few surprises at you this evening. I'm sure you'll get the gist of what my subject will be as we carry on. I have some announcements to make as we near the end of our semester. There's only one more session after tonight's broadcast. That is next Tuesday at 7 for session number 14. And if all goes according to plan, I'll have a very special guest who has been good enough to join me each and every semester for the last, 12 years that we've been doing this program, Jazz in the Modern Era. And again, according to plan, he will be joined by a very, very special person who has a very important message for all of you about this music and the steps being taken to take care of the musicians who may be in need. But that's next week, getting ahead of myself. Again, for session 13, we opened up with Shirley Horn, the trio stretching out at the Vine Street Bar and Grill. We're going to continue now with a quartet of note headed up by pianist Jerry Allen. This is Jerry Allen's quartet. And they are going to perform a Jerry Allen composition entitled Unconditional Love. Enjoy this. ¶¶ very wistful, the very beautiful ballad entitled Unconditional Love, written by the pianist in this band, this extraordinary band, Miss Jerry Allen. Four giants, Jerry Allen at the piano, Tineke Postma on soprano saxophone, Esperanza Spalding on bass, and Terry Lynn Carrington on drums. This was recorded just last year, this great quartet in concert. And what you saw, four female instrumentalists in their own group performing in concert, not so unusual now, but in the not too distant past, what you just saw probably wouldn't have never taken place. Stay tuned. Our theme, I'm going to feature some of the great female instrumentalists in the history of this music. I'm not going to cover all of them because we don't have enough time, but I'm going to try to cover as many points as I can with regard to the contributions of some of the great women instrumentalists in jazz's history. Very often when you think women in this music, and let's face it, this music was and continues to be pretty much a boys' club, but there are some very, very significant women who perform and performed this music, and they performed it in ways other than vocalizing. They were playing upright bass. They were playing at the kit, the drum kit. They were playing the saxophones, as you saw demonstrated in what you just heard. And of course, any number of wonderful lady pianists, and Jerry Allen is one in a long line of great, great female pianists. But tonight I'm going to share a little history, provide a little historical perspective with regard to, let's face it, the racism and sexism that women faced in huge quantity in the not too distant past, and to some degree still have to endure the men in the band who make this music. My hope is that this will shed some light on the contributions of some of the wonderful female instrumentalists, and I'm going to try to cover as many as I can in the 3 hours we have allotted. I'm going to go back in history. As a matter of fact, we're going to go back. This last tune, Unconditional Love, was performed just last year in concert. We're going to go back to 1968 in France. The Count Basie Orchestra was appearing. And on the stand with the Basie Orchestra was Miss Lady Soul herself, Miss Vi Red, playing alto saxophone and wailing. You know the tune, Stormy Monday Blues. This is Vi Red with the Count Basie Orchestra circa 1968. We'll be right back. is Vi Red, Waylon, on alto saxophone and vocalizing as well. Stormy Monday Blues, a classic from 1968, Vi Red performing with the Count Basie Orchestra. Vi Red, one of the pioneering women in the world of jazz. And I had the opportunity and pleasure of interviewing Vi Red as part of the World Stage Story series that colleagues Jeffrey Winston, who I hope is going to join me next week, Clint Rosemond, who was with me last week, and myself, we put together a series of interviews with some of the greats in this business. And Vi Red joined us for an evening of interviews, and she also performed a little bit as part of that series. And a lot of the information she shared with the audience was very, very thought-provoking. In as much as Vi, as an instrumentalist, as an alto saxophone, had to endure a whole lot in working with her male colleagues. And some of that will come to light as we continue this evening. But Miss Vi Red was one of the giants. Vi Red, again on alto saxophone, working with the Basie Band. And I got a question whether that was a soprano or a clarinet. I just want to make it very, very clear. That was an alto saxophone. And if you recall, last week, my theme was the saxophonist, and we featured some of the giants on all of the four most common saxophones, that is the soprano, the alto, the tenor, and the baritone. In this case, Vi Red playing alto saxophone. Again, Stormy Monday Blues, recorded in France, 1968. We're going to carry on now with another giant on the distaff side. We're going to go back to 1960. This lady, truly a pioneer in the world of jazz, given again, just like Vi Red, all that she had to endure to break into the boys' club. And in this case, the wonderful trombonist Miss Melba Liston is working with the Quincy Jones Orchestra. And this is Melba's interpretation of My Reverie. We'll come back.
Thank you.
truly one of the giants, male or female, of the trombone. And what set Melba Liston apart from so many of her contemporaries is she was not only a great trombonist, but she was also a wonderful composer, and most especially, arranger. One of the most respected female instrumentalists of all time is Melba Liston. And in this case, you heard her in concert with Quincy Jones Orchestra in Switzerland, 1960. And oh, by the way, the only other female in that orchestra at the time was pianist Patti Bowne. A little trivia for your, your listening and viewing pleasure. But again, Melba Liston, another giant, along with the great Vi Reade, and they blazed a path of four ladies that continues to be followed. And if you were with us at the top where you observed the Jerry Allen Quartet in concert, those young women, Esperanza Spalding, Terry Lynn Carrington, and Tineke Postma, they walk on the shoulders of people like Melba Liston and Vi Reade, truly pioneering women in this man's world called jazz. Before I go any further, a quick announcement to make, a little housekeeping, if you will. It's that time, folks. Those of you who are enrolled, you know that a due date is right around the corner, as a matter of fact. If you have the syllabus, you know, and if you've received all of my emails to those of you enrolled, you know that your project is due this Friday. I've received a few, but just know that your due date, as it indicates on the screen, is Friday. I'm going to give you a reprieve for those of you who are last minute people, inasmuch as most of you are sending your projects to me electronically, and that's great, that's wonderful. Some of you continue to utilize snail mail, and I'm certain that some of you will probably be coming to campus to drop your project off, and you'll probably try to come to campus on the day that the project is due. You won't be successful if you come to campus this Friday because Cal State Dominguez Hills officially is closed on Friday in observance of the Thanksgiving Day holiday. So here's your reprieve. For those of you that haven't submitted your project at this point in time, and again, you've waited till the last minute to complete it, I'm going to change that date from Friday the 29th to Monday, the following Monday, December 2nd. So make certain that if you're not able to get your project to me, for those that are going to deliver it in person, if you are still struggling to put the finishing touches on that project, you have until Monday when the campus reopens, Monday, December 2nd, to get that project to me. So just make that note. Any questions, any concerns about finishing your project and getting it to me, whether it be in person, whether it be via snail mail or electronically, there's my contact information. You know that information by heart, I suspect, at this point in time. An email address as well as a phone number. So feel free to give me a call if there are any issues. If not, I expect to have all the projects in no later than the end of the day, Monday, December 2nd. And when I say the end of the day, what I mean is the end of the work day, which generally is about 5 p.m. So there's your reprieve, a two-day grace period for those of you that are struggling. Just know that. Our theme this evening, I'm featuring some of the great female instrumentalists in the history of jazz. Just a little background. Back in the 20s and more so in the 30s, there were a number of all-female jazz orchestras. Probably the most noted were Blanche Calloway's all-girl orchestra. Blanche Calloway, you may be familiar with that name. Blanche Calloway was Cab Calloway's big sister. Well, she had an all-female band. As did Ada Leonard. Ada Leonard had an all-female band back in the 1930s of note. In addition, Ina Ray Hutton and her Melodeers, they were prominent in the 1930s. You say, well, why an all-female band? Well, the fact of the matter is, for all intents and purposes, they weren't allowed to play with the men. There was an unwritten rule on the part of many male band leaders and orchestra members that women weren't good enough to sit alongside them in an orchestra or band. And in response to that thought process, many young women formed their own all-girl groups. So again, you had Ada Leonard's band, Blanche Calloway's band. There are a number of them. They were probably the most prominent. And of course, Ina Ray Hutton and her Melodeers. In the early 1940s, actually in the late 1930s, Miss Anna Mae Wynburn, she headed up an all-male orchestra, jazz orchestra. But of course, I think all of us are aware of the fact that in the early 1940s, America went to war. And in that process, a number of male instrumentalists who were members of the various orchestras of the time, and there were a lot of big bands traveling throughout America. Many of the men were drafted and went off to war. And that left a void that Anna Mae Wynburn filled by forming the International Sweethearts of Rhythm, an all-female jazz orchestra. But what set that orchestra apart from most, if not all, of the other all-female orchestras slash bands was this was an integrated band. Black, white, Asian women, young women, came together and formed this probably the pioneering all female band. They traveled the country in the 1940s, East Coast, West Coast. They even traveled in the South, where because of Jim Crow and the fact that segregation was the law of the land back in the 1940s, many of the women, particularly the white women and the Asian women, had to color their skin. They had to wear dark makeup in order to travel with that orchestra. Now that's a switch, think about that. But the fact of the matter is they were the first truly integrated all-female jazz orchestra under the leadership of Miss Anna Mae Wynburn. We're going to feature this pioneering orchestra in concert in 1946 with Anna Mae Wynburn out front vocalizing on the tune Jump Children, backed by the International Sweethearts of Rhythm. Anna Mae Wynburn leading this wonderful all-female orchestra. 1946, the tune Jump Children. That brief tenor saxophone break was played by Miss Viola Burnside, a very, very prominent saxophonist during that period. The International Sweethearts of Rhythm, again, another pioneering orchestra. that were popular for roughly 6 to 8 years. And again, they blazed a path. And all of the things that they had to endure as women instrumentalists were, needless to say, trying at best. Stay tuned. Our subject, the female instrumentalists, trying to feature as many as I can in our allotted time frame. Next up, a lady who, again, I had the pleasure of interviewing not only as part of the World Stage Stories series out in Leimert Park at the World Stage, but also, oh, good heavens, maybe 10 years ago, she came in and joined me right here at Cal State Dominguez Hills, and we talked about her career, her impact on the music, her continued impact on young women in this business. She's a teacher, trumpet player, and one of the great personalities of our time. I'm talking about, of course, the trumpetist, Miss Clora Bryant. I'm going to feature Miss Clora Bryant on her 1957 date entitled Clora Bryant, Gal with a Horn, and she's going to interpret Gypsy in My Soul. This is the music of Miss Clora Bryant.
Someone is calling me from way out yonder. It's just a gypsy in my soul. There is no greater life of which I'm fonder. It's just a gypsy in my soul. Ain't got no cares, got no strings. I am fancy free, and I love to wander. It's just a gypsy in my soul. If I am fancy free, and I love to wander, it's just a gypsy in my soul.
Clora Bryant, the trumpetist out front, vocalizing and playing trumpet, the tune The Gypsy in My Soul. And her band at the time from 1957 included the Roger Fleming at the piano, Ben Tucker on bass, Bruce Freeman on drums, and in the ensemble section, Mr. Walter Benton on tenor saxophone. Miss Clora Bryant, the trumpetist, what a wonderful spirit in this music, and she blazed a path along with Vi Red and Melba Liston, and had to deal with the indignities of working around men much of the time. Many of whom didn't want her in the band, they didn't feel she was up to snuff, but you could hear her mastery of the trumpet, as well as her vocals. She could play as well as anybody, fact of the matter is. And of course, the indignities of dealing with those hounds in the bands who wanted to not only play in the ensemble, but would also wanted to do some other playing as well that we won't get into this evening. But nevertheless, another pioneer, Miss Clora Bryant. And it was truly an honor for me to have her here out at Cal State Dominguez Hills and share her experiences. And we also did a roughly 15-minute video of Clora talking about her career, how she decided she was going to be a trumpet player, her experiences on Central Avenue, her interactions with some of the great trumpet giants like Louis Armstrong and Dizzy Gillespie, among many others. And maybe time permitting, next week, our final broadcast, I'll share that video with you. But we'll play kind of play it by ear. But again, please mark down Miss Clora Bryant as a true music pioneer, along with Melba Liston, Vi Red, and those to come. Just this year, a few months ago, there was a showing here locally of a video entitled The Girls in the Band, a Judy Chaikin production. And what it portrayed were the indignities, again, as I alluded to earlier, that women instrumentalists had to endure in trying to break into the boys' club of of jazz. And some of the commentary is provided by the one, the only, Miss Clora Bryant. What I'm going to do is share. This is a preview that was put together a few years back and was uploaded to YouTube. The actual full-length motion picture, if you will, was just released this year. You can get the DVD if you go to thegirlsintheband.com. And I highly recommend that you get your hands on a copy of The Girls in the Band. Again, a Judy Chaikin production. If you go to thegirlsintheband.com, you can get more information on how to secure this extraordinary video that shares some of those trials and tribulations I've talked about ever so briefly this evening. I'm going to do a share, roughly a 7-minute preview of this video, and I think you'll get a feel for what you can expect if you get your hands on a copy. So again, this is a preview of The Girls in the Band. If you go back to pre-World War II days and even post-World War II, where literally women weren't allowed in many instances to perform with men on the bandstand, at least as instrumentalists. If you were a vocalist out front wearing your pretty dress, that was one thing. But actually playing in the trumpet section or the saxophone section, oh, that was a no-no in most instances. And slowly but surely, changes took place. And The Girls in the Band truly does a marvelous job of sharing that story. So let's take a look at that preview.
The joy of playing music.
~95% of my life is music.
All these women were playing horns and drums and basses and everything. I'd never seen that before.
We stand all around the corner whenever we play. And we travel all over Germany, France, Belgium.
The rocket chair to rock. A rubber ball of roll takes a long tall daddy to satisfy my soul. Baby rocks me with that steady roll.
I had been directing a professional male orchestra. And of course, the draft board had taken a lot of my men. And when I first joined the International Sweethearts, I said, what a bunch of cute little girls, but I don't know whether I could get along with that many women or not.
Do you want to jump, children?
Yeah!
Do you want to jump, children?
Yeah!
Jump, 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 jump!
I played with the greatest female band ever.
I had the best seat in the house. I was watching the show go on, and I'm sitting in the rhythm section.
I loved every minute of it. Every minute.
There's this quality of life as you're living it in the moment. That's what keeps jazz what it is.
You can't play jazz unless you feel it in here.
Really, it's unexplainable. The blues is the basis of everything in jazz.
If Mary Lou Williams had been a man, she would have been able to do so much more for the music, for herself.
All the guys were scared of Mary Lou in Melbourne. And I can see why they would be. Those women knew what they were doing, and they knew how to play, and they were tough.
The guys can have white hair and glasses and weigh 300 pounds, but if they can play, great. The girls, they want to look like a bunch of young starlets.
Now when you break your chicks, you pick them big and fat. You can bet your booze that it's tight like that.
You had to have girls who think more about how they looked than how they played.
Guys just didn't want chicks on their bandstand.
A bunch of women in the world trying to make their place in the world among musicians where prejudice existed because they were women.
I may be small, but baby, I have no fear. I can climb a hill without shifting gears.
We didn't get exposure like Inaree Hutton's band or other orchestras. By being a mixed group with different nationalities, well, we didn't have the exposure that they had.
Lil Armstrong and I were pretty good friends at that time. She was married to Louis Armstrong, and even she had a tough time.
You know, from a physical standpoint, it would seem that women in music do best when they play the piano. And this is probably because it takes less physical effort to play the piano than, say, a wind instrument or, for that matter, the drums. And to prove how right Duke is, here is Marion McPartland right now playing I Could Write a Book.
People used to pay me a compliment, they thought it was. She plays just like a man.
Honestly, did you consider that you were working under a handicap to try to make a profession of being a jazz pianist as a woman?
Well, it has never been a handicap, Gene, truly, and I really don't think about it. I just think of myself as a musician working with other musicians.
You put a bunch of musicians behind a curtain, and who's going to tell me who's the female playing or who's the male playing? You can't do that. I'm a musician first, and I just happen to be female.
The fun lasted until we started doing one-nighters in the South.
While traveling through the South, we'd pull into a service station, and the guy would come out with his gun and say, we don't have any black toilets. You niggas go out in the field and squat.
The black bands were very good, and they bumped into a lot of problems where they wouldn't be able to work because they were black.
The white world was completely unaware of us because most of our venues all over the country were played in black venues.
They wouldn't stand for us mixing. I was dying to get hold of a girl one time that was a trumpet player, and she was just great. And I wanted to put her in the band, you know. And they said, we can't do it because there are a lot of people that would object to a mixed racial band.
There could be no fraternization between the races, except in the commercial endeavor. But in public, there was no contact of any kind, and everything was segregated.
If we were in a theater, the white folks would be downstairs, and the ropes would be dividing the blacks and the whites.
I think that the whole point of jazz has an element of freedom to it. But you cannot avoid the racism. You can't avoid what the effects of it are. And they're devastating because they still serve to divide people.
I was surrounded by the girls with so much love, and yet I knew that I was provoking fear in others. And then so many times I felt so embarrassed for my race, so humiliated by them. I wanted to lash out at them. Those were rough days. Rough times, scary times.
Well, I'm so glad that being a woman and coming along when I did, that they finally accepted me for who I am and what I do and why I do it.
When you see those girls playing those trumpets and trombones, and I'm talking about playing them, man is going to have to realize you can't stop them. You can't stop them.
Well, you just got a taste of what this video is about, called The Girls in the Band. If you go online and see this cover, I think we can take a picture of it for you, and you can burn it into your brain and look for this DVD. It's truly an experience. For those of you who truly want more information beyond the actual recordings, you need to check this video out. Again, it's called The Girls in the Band. And it's available if you go to thegirlsintheband.com. Highly recommended, folks. Check it out. And it'll expand on what you just heard. That in spite of the racism, the sexism, these women continued to flourish, continued to play their music. And you saw several excerpts from Miss Clora Bryant, who we just featured. By the way, a quick aside, you also heard some commentary from Miss Bertha Hope. Bertha Hope, very, very prominent pianist, continues to perform on the East Coast where she resides. And oh, by the way, Bertha Hope's brother was here with me last week, Mr. Clint Rosemond. And it was a pleasure to have Clint come in and talk about the saxophonist. But just note that a very, very prominent pianist, his sister Bertha Hope, continues to perform. And comes out here on occasion to the West Coast, but her home is the East Coast. And he shared with me that she just performed a concert along with some prominent jazz people out at Minton's Playhouse. That's right. They've resurrected Minton's Playhouse in Harlem. And Bertha Hope, Clint Rosemond's sister, performed there just recently. So just another quick aside. Our subject: women in jazz, specifically women instrumentalists. Next up, another very, very prominent female instrumentalist who some of you may not be familiar with, but once again, she blazed a path that continues to resonate in the world of jazz. I'm talking about Miss Valeda Snow, trumpeter, vocalist, pioneering woman in jazz. We're going to go back to 1946. This is Valeda Snow, along with the Ali Baba Trio. Now, please make this note as you're watching this video. In their infinite wisdom, the folks who released this as part of a Soundy in 1946. Now, and I'm not certain if it's the people who actually produced the Soundy that were responsible for this error, but somebody was responsible for it. The quality of the video is excellent. The audio is solid. The only problem is the image is reversed. So don't be concerned that Valeda Snow is playing trumpet as if she were left-handed and all the members of the trio are playing as if they were left-handed. It's just that the image was reversed, but I want you just to get a feel for Miss Valeda Snow and her trumpet stylings, ever so brief. A trumpet break, her vocal stylings, but again, in the annals of jazz, Valeda Snow plays a very, very prominent role. So again, 1946, Patience and Fortitude is the tune.
Patience and fortitude, patience and fortitude, patience and fortitude, and things will come your way. When you have solitude, can make life dull and cruel, patience and fortitude, then things will come your way. Couldn't wait
can see it's a big mistake. Patience and 42, patience and 42, patience and 42, then things will come your way. River wears the rust of rock with patience 42. Rust will spoil the strongest lock with patience 42. Hottest fires will soon grow cold, patience 42. Orphan Nanny will grow old at patience 42.
Hallelujah.
Patience and 42, patience and 42, patience and 42, then things will come your way. Hallelujah. With patience 42. Dick Tracy will get a rest, have patience 42. Pullman trains will soon have faith, have patience 42. Crosby's horse will win a race, have patience 42.
No danger.
Patience and 42. Patience and 42.
One and the only Miss Valeda Snow, who had a huge influence on the trumpetist, Clora Bryant. You got a taste of her artistry working with the Alibaba Trio, 1946, a soundie. Soundies were the first music videos produced in the 1940s into the early 1950s. And you just got a taste of what those old soundies looked like. Miss Valeda Snow, Patience and Fortitude, again, 1946. In the previous video, you saw a number of women talk about the all-female orchestras, the racism and sexism that they had to endure. And you heard mention made of arguably the most prominent, the most important female jazz history in its history, Miss Mary Lou Williams. Just a little background. Back in 1958, and I've talked about this on several occasions this semester, and I always do each and every semester, back in 1958, a photographer who was little known in 1958, but went on to bigger and better things. I don't know about better, but bigger things. Well, maybe not so big after all. In 1958, Art Kane was commissioned to photograph a group of jazz musicians that became, and that subsequent photograph and the story behind it, became the subject of a 1994 documentary, which was nominated for an Academy Award. But more importantly, that photograph went on to be one of the most iconic photographs of all time, no matter the genre, called A Great Day in Harlem. And not quite 60 musicians came together in the late morning and were photographed. And there were three women of the roughly 60 musicians in that photograph, two of whom were briefly profiled in that video you just saw about the girls in the band. One was a pianist, radio host of renown, Miss Marion McPartland. The other, pianist, composer, arranger, highly influential musically on so many musicians, including the likes of Thelonious Monk, among many, many others, Miss Mary Lou Williams. What we're going to do is provide for you a brief profile of Miss Mary Lou Williams with commentary about this extraordinary musician. And then we're going to, from there, feature Mary Lou Williams in concert in solo fashion. But first up, first things first, this is a brief profile of Miss Mary Lou Williams.
Webster, the great storyteller. He had studied with Lester Young's father. And he would tell me about the times that Prez would take him on his gig because he liked the way Ben comped on the piano.
All right, false start. What you just saw was a profile, I think, of Thelonious Monk. That was Johnny Griffin talking about Monk. Johnny Griffin played with Monk back in the 50s. But as part of this Great Day in Harlem DVD, there was the actual film itself of the making of the photograph that was taken in 1958 in front of a Harlem brownstone. And a second DVD as part of that package was profiles of all the musicians who posed for that photograph, including, again, two of the three women that appeared in that photograph. And this one is one of the two, Miss Mary Lou Williams. So let's go take two, a brief profile of Miss Mary Lou Williams.
Mary Lou was more coming out of the Chicago and Earl Hines style and developing her own style.
No, she was multi-talented, arranger, composer.
She was a teacher. She was always a teacher.
But she was really not a stride pianist. Her expertise was a more individual.
Well, the thing about Mary Lou was she moved along with the times. Here she started out with this wonderful down-swinging music with Andy Kirk, but by the time that these musicians were talking about, she was listening to bebop and writing a lot of modern stuff.
This is actually Dizzy Gillespie, who was working on In the Land of Ubla Dee with her.
It was sort of a bebop think tank, I guess, up
a
there.
A bebop think tank, yeah, wonderful.
And she ultimately wound up down at Duke University as the artist in residence. Now, the usual stay there, I think, for the artist in residence was probably up to 2 years, but her classes were so popular that they kept her on for 9 years. Just throngs of kids would come in and sit in and listen. But as she was analyzing music for the class, she seemed only to like the upbeat stuff. That was her feeling about music. So when they'd get to some kind of moody Ellington piece or something, she didn't want to analyze that. So her great friend and mentor and companion and spiritual advisor, a young man named Peter O'Brien, Father Peter O'Brien, a Jesuit priest, he would take over and he would talk about the Ellington stuff. He was devoted to her and had been interested in all kinds of music from an early age. As a matter of fact, at his ordination, Mabel Mercer sang at a very unusual ordination of a young priest.
This is a rosary.
They were great companions, and she relied on him to keep her going. She wrote very inspirational stuff for the church. She had become a very devout Catholic.
When she became born again, she tried to convert me and everybody else she met.
You know, Mary Lou wrote the mass, and we played it in Newport.
And her mass was very lively. They played it at St. Patrick's Cathedral when she died. Dizzy played it, and choruses of little children, and it was all the celebration. And that's what her music was like.
That was the highlight of the mass. It was nice.
Some of the people that played were, I think Hazel Scott got, well, Hazel Scott was there, but I think it was Rose Murphy who got up and sang, "I can't even do this because I get choked up." She sang, she sang Mary Lou, I Love You. Peter O'Brien was so distraught at Mary Lou's death to think that she wouldn't be around to continue this wonderful work that he set about collecting all the material he could about her. She had made some very important recordings, these suites that she wrote with various movements. She had limitless energy and just wrote all the time, and everything was just deathless. Some of the compositions that had not been recorded, he got those done by representative musicians, got them on record. She saved everything. So, I mean, he practically has laundry lists, literally. He has menus from places where she played, all kinds of clippings, and objects, things. They're all collected out in Rutgers at the Institute for Jazz Study. Dresses of hers. It's a marvelous, marvelous archive. It was a toss-up between the Smithsonian, who wanted the stuff, and Rutgers, but I think he figured that Smithsonian is so vast and there's so much stuff there, and Rutgers had just gotten a big grant, so everything is temperature controlled. It's a beautiful display of everything about Mary Lou, so he's keeping her flame alive.
Mary Lou Williams. Much of the commentary was provided by a radio producer and the woman, if not most involved, very, very involved in the production of this great 1994 documentary, A Great Day in Harlem, Miss Jean Bock. And you even heard Dizzy Gillespie, who hobnobbed with Mary Lou Williams back in the day, commenting about working with Mary Lou Williams and in the mass she wrote that was performed at the Newport Jazz Festival. Just an extraordinary musician, again, very, very influential. She would have some of the great, great giants, the Coleman Hawkinses, the Thelonious Monks, over to her house, showing them the ropes, if you will. She mastered every style in this music. She, again, worked with the great stride pianist all the way up through the avant-garde. She worked with Cecil Taylor, among others. So she spanned the realm of jazz in her lifetime. Miss Mary Lou Williams, truly one of the most important musicians in the history of jazz. Next up, Mary Lou Williams in concert at the Montreux Jazz Festival in Switzerland, 1978. And this tune that she wrote is entitled Offertory Meditation, Miss Mary Lou Williams. The brilliant Miss Mary Lou Williams in concert at Montreux, the Montreux Jazz Festival in Switzerland, 1978. I apologize for the audio and video not being in sync, but nevertheless, I think you get an idea of what an extraordinary musician Mary Lou Williams was. And in the pantheon of female jazz instrumentalists, Mary Lou Williams is right at the top, as influential as any musician in the history of jazz. Truly a remarkable figure. And if you have an opportunity to either pull up some YouTube footage of Mary Lou Williams in concert, or have an opportunity to pick up some of her music in CD form or whatever form you can get, whether it be an old 78 or albums, LPs, pick it up. You won't be disappointed. Brilliant, brilliant musician. In the first half of our broadcast this evening, we featured some of the more prominent female instrumentalists in the history of jazz. For the remaining roughly 90 minutes plus, we are going to play some of the more contemporary giants. We kicked off with Shirley Horn, who left us several years ago. We followed that up with Jerry Allen and her quartet, young women who continue to make this music what it is, including the likes of Esperanza Spalding, and I don't have to talk about her exploits. I think if you know anything about this music and have been keeping up with the music, you know all of the music that this young woman has produced. Her versatility, she's a master on the upright bass as well as the electric bass. She plays with all the cats, East Coast in particular, although she spent most of her life here on the West Coast up in the Bay Area. She's worked with any number of greats, including Joe Lovano, continues to work in his band, and many, many others. She tours and leads her own groups. Of course, drummer Terry Lynn Carrington leads her own band. She's worked with the likes of Herbie Hancock and Stan Getz, among many, many others. Jerry Allen, of course, one of the great pianists, male or female, in the business, and continues to tour. And Tineke Postma is an extraordinary saxophonist who primarily works in Europe, but she gets to the States on occasion, and she is a first-call saxophonist, whether it be soprano saxophone or alto saxophone. She's a giant as well. Maybe not as well-known as the three previous women I mentioned, but she's still young, and she's truly made a name for herself at this point in time and will continue to do so. What we're going to do now is feature another great, great female instrumentalist, namely Miss Regina Carter, violinist supreme. She's working with the Pablo Ziegler Quartet. This was recorded at the Jazz Standard in New York City back in 2010. They are going to interpret Astor Piazzolla's Michelangelo 70. We'll come back. Thank you. true virtuoso, Miss Regina Carter, on violin, working with the Pablo Ziegler aggregation. The tune was written by arguably the single most important figure in the history of tango, Mr. Astor Piazzolla. He's considered Argentina's greatest cultural export. And his stature is equivalent in terms of tango to Duke Ellington's in jazz, Astor Piazzolla. As a matter of fact, oh, maybe a semester and a half, like maybe a year and a half ago, I had as my guest a gentleman who indicated that Astor Piazzolla was one of his influences, and his name just left my brain again, and I'll remember his name in just a moment. Please forgive me. But anyway, Astor Piazzolla wrote the tune called Michelangelo 70. The gentleman in the band, Pablo Ziegler at the piano, played with Astor Piazzolla for many, many years. Claudio Ragazzi on guitar, Hector Del Curto on bandoneon. The bandoneon, an accordion-like instrument that the composer Astor Piazzolla specialized on, and Pedro Giraudo on bass, Michelangelo 70. Pablo Ziegler featuring the wonderful Miss Regina Carter on violin. The gentleman in question, whose name flew away, suddenly came back, Mr. Greg Perret, guitar supreme. Greg came in and spent some time with us and described his love of classical guitar. And Astor Piazzolla definitely was an influence on Greg. And Greg continues to make music in and around Southern California on a regular basis with his own band. The influences are everywhere, folks. In this case, Regina Carter and a tango-like tune. And you saw her brilliance on that fiddle. We're going to continue now with another brilliant young reed person, Miss Annette Cohen, working with another virtuoso, Mr. Paquito de Rivera. But I'm going to put the spotlight on Annette Cohen, a young woman who from Israel, who has lived in the States now for a number of years and is one of the great, great woodwind artists in the world. And she's working with this band in, I believe it's in Uruguay. This goes back to 2012. As you can see, jazz is all over the world. I've shared music this evening from places like Switzerland, France. In this case, we're going to go to Uruguay. Of course, the last tune you heard was recorded in New York. But in this case, Annette Cohen with Paquito de Rivera's band. Both of them are on clarinet, and they're going to interpret a tune, and then I'll talk about this tune and its composer when we come back. The tune, Umacero, this goes back to 2012, Annette Cohen and Paquito de Rivera. Thank you. I think they were having fun up on stage, and that's so beautiful to see. Master musicians having fun on the stand. And in this case, two of the great reed people of all time, Paquito de Rivera and Anat Cohen, both of whom in this case were playing clarinet. Very intricate interplay on a tune entitled Umacero, written by someone you may not be familiar with, Brazilian composer and flutist who was born in the 19th century and continued into the 20th century, Mr. Alfredo Viana. His contemporaries called him Pixinguinha, Pixinguinha, great Brazilian musician who left a body of work, and that's just one example of the many compositions he left the world. And the fact of the matter is, not a whole lot of folks know about Pixinguinha, Mr. Alfredo Viana. Nevertheless, that's a taste of it from Anat Cohen, Paquito de Rivera. The other folks in the band, speaking of female brilliant female instrumentalists, that was Renee Rosnes on piano. Todd Coolman on bass. He worked many years with James Moody. Moody always introduced him as the Cool Man. Well, his last name is Coolman. And on drums, Mr. Adam Nussbaum from Uruguay at a jazz festival there just last year, 2012. Great, great, great stuff. Next up, we're going to lay a little gospel on you a little bit and feature a band, in this case, Archie Shepp's Quartet. And in his band at the time was a wonderful woman who plays some serious piano and also vocalizes as well on what you're about to hear. Someone that you may or may not be familiar with, Miss Amina Claudine Myers. Archie Shepp, the Quartet, they're going to do a little tune that Amina Claudine Myers wrote entitled You Gotta Call Him. This was recorded in Germany in 2001.
Call him in the midnight hour. Call him. filled with pain. You feel your life is in vain. Got to keep your faith in God. He'll protect you from the greatest fall. You just gotta call. Claudine, I mean Myers. A piece written by Claudine Myers. You gotta call him.
The Archie Shepp Quartet. Archie, one of those original fire spitters from the 60s who later in his career, he softened his approach very often. He was into ballads, just straight ahead bebop, but back in the 60s, when he and the likes of Pharoah Saunders and, of course, the late, great John Coltrane were breathing fire, Archie was right there with him. But Archie, not only a great saxophonist, but you heard him vocalizing as well. Archie does poetry. He does it all. The great Archie Shepp out front. And his pianist, Miss Amina Claudine Myers. The other cats in the band, Morgan Moore, Wayne Dockery on bass and Ronnie Bourage on drums. This was recorded again 2001 in Germany at one of their most famous jazz festivals. And again, with the spotlight on the women in jazz in this case, someone that some of you may not be real familiar with, but a wonderful pianist, vocalist, but in particular, her piano stylings are as solid as anybody, Miss Amina Claudine Myers. She too was a part of the AACM, those young jazz musicians who explored, in some cases, the outer fringes of the music, the AACM, the Association for the Advancement of Creative Musicians out of Chicago. And a lot of the great giants came out of that organization, including Miss Amina Claudine Myers. But in this case, she shared her gospel roots with you, with Archie Shepp. Next up, we're going to Quebec in Canada. Just last year, we're going to feature wonderful young Canadian pianist, Marianne Trudell. And in this case, she's working with truly one of the finest trumpeters in the world, Miss Ingrid Jensen. If you were with me earlier on in the broadcast, you heard the great trumpetist, Miss Clora Bryant, and you also saw on one of the great soundies from the 40s, Miss Valeda Snow playing her trumpet. In this case, this is Ingrid Jensen, who continues to perform on a regular basis around the world. And you've heard me kind of make this statement before, one of the great trumpeters, male or female, in the business. But in this case, Ingrid Jensen working with Marianne Trudell and her quartet, again, from 2012. The name of the tune, very simply, Soon, written by Miss Marianne Trudell.
Thank you. Thank you.
The brilliance of trumpeter Ingrid Jensen, working with the Mary Ann Trudell Band. Mary Ann Trudell, brilliant young Canadian pianist, who wrote that tune entitled Soon, very introspective tune. The gentleman on the date, Morgan Moore on bass and Robbie Custer on drums. This was recorded last year, 2012, in Quebec. Again, another example of women who, there are no boundaries, they just go out and play. A very different scene than 40, 50 years ago, when very often they simply weren't allowed to play with the guys. But now that some of those barriers have been removed, you see male and female coming together to make some beautiful music together. Mary Ann Trudell and Ingrid Jensen. As we move into our third and final hour of session number 13 of IDS 336, Jazz in the Modern Era, I want to once again and for the last time indicate to those of you enrolled that your project is due very soon. And if you weren't with me earlier on when I gave you some details, I did extend the deadline to Monday, December 12th. So you notice that it says Friday, this Friday, the 29th. We'll just make a note, if you would, that I've extended it to Monday, December 2nd. The reason being that if you attempt, for those of you who are going to deliver it in person on Friday when it's due, or the original due date, the campus will be closed. So if you still want to deliver it in person, hang until Monday, December 2nd, and then drop by campus. There's the new due date. And drop your project off, and all will be right with the world. And get it here before, I said 5, you probably want to make it earlier than 5 if possible, but there's your new due date. So you've got another couple of days to work on your project for you last minute folks out there. And again, if you have any questions, here's my contact information. I fully expect that if you had questions, you would have called me a long time ago, but I know how things are. You're busy people with full schedules, and maybe this particular project was placed on the back burner, but now it's front burner time, so get busy. I expect them all to be in by Monday, and I will not accept anything after Monday afternoon. Just make a note. Our theme, the female jazz instrumentalist of note. If you were with me earlier, I shared information about some of the earlier pioneers, among them trumpeter Vleda Snow, trumpeter Clora Bryan, saxophonist Vi Red, trombonist and arranger, composer Melba Liston, among others. Also talked about some of the girl bands back in the 30s and 40s, with probably the most notable being the Ida Mae Wynburn and her international sweethearts of rhythm that performed. Their heyday was roughly between 1940 and 1946. Truly the first integrated all-female jazz orchestra. And they were quite the sensation back in the 1940s. Next up, we're going to go back to the year 2008 and feature a young woman who's very simply a brilliant pianist, and she goes by the name Hiromi. Her given name is Hiromi Uehara from Japan, and in this case, she's working with her band that she calls Sonic Boom. How about that for the name of a band? That should give you a hint about what you're about to hear. This is Hiromi's Sonic Boom, and they're going to play the tune Time Difference from 2008. Check this out. This is truly an example. For those of you that are into labels, fasten your seatbelts. This is fusion at its most aggressive, but yet melodic. Enjoy this. We'll be right back. Romy Sonic Boom. That's the name of the band. The tune, Time Difference, from 2008. Folks in the band, of course, Hiromi out front on acoustic piano and synthesizer. The one, the only, Mr. David Fusinski on guitar, Tony Gray on bass, and Martin Valahora on drums. Hiromi Weihara is her last name. And exciting stuff, straight ahead. One of the prodigious pianists out there who has made a number of albums, both solo as well as her own band, Sonic Boom, and continues to make great, great music, and she's still a young woman, great to hear. Hiromi. Next up, if you're with me at the beginning, I featured Jerry Allen's band, her quartet, from 2012. And in the band was that young phenom, prodigy, on drums, Miss Terry Lynn Carrington. And as I mentioned earlier, she's played with so many of the great giants, Stan Getz, Herbie Hancock, and that's just the short list. In this case, we're gonna play relatively recent Terry Lynn Carrington. A few years back, she had a project she called the Mosaic Project, where she brought some of the most prominent female musicians in the world together to record this seminal album. And she has taken that show on the road. Now, what you're going to see is not an all-female band, but nevertheless, she calls it her Mosaic Project. And you know what? What we're going to do is we're going to let Terry Lynn Carrington, that phenomenal drummer, announce the tune that the band is going to play. I think you'll like this because it has a real contemporary sensibility to it.
Fuller's next CD, which is called Angelic Warrior, and the name of this song is Body and Soul. Very cool rendition of Body and Soul. Thank you.
Miss Terry Lynn Carrington and her band, Terry Lynn Carrington out front, not out front, but leader of the band on drums, of course. Truly a prodigy, extraordinary drummer. On alto saxophone, Miss Tia Fuller. She is a recording artist in her own right, has a few albums out, and has made a huge splash because she can handle that alto saxophone like few others. Just a wonderful talent. In fact, I had an opportunity to attend a concert in the not-too-distant past that featured Diane Reeves and her band. And in the expanded ensemble, Tia Fuller was sitting in the alto saxophone chair and just making wonderful music. By the way, standing next to her was a trumpeter, Mr. Ambrose Akinmusiri. Some of you are familiar with Ambrose's wonderful work. That's quite a front line, working with Miss Diane Reeves. And by the way, this particular video was done in Spain in last year, 2012. And what you didn't see is following this rendition of Body and Soul, Diane Reeves came out, and I believe she's saying, "Will You Still Love Me Tomorrow?" But anyway, check it out. It's all on YouTube. Again, the band, Terry Lynn Carrington on drums, Tia Fuller on alto saxophone, Helen Sung on piano, another phenomenal recording artist, has made a number of albums where she's led those dates. Helen Sung on guitar, Mr. Near Felder, and on drums, the one, the only, Mr. Joshua Ari Brozowski. Again, Terry Lynn Carrington, her Mosaic project, with the spotlight on the three women in the band, Terry Lynn Carrington on drums, Tia Fuller on alto saxophone, and Helen Sung at the piano. Not unusual these days, thank goodness, that men and women can come together and make wonderful music, as I mentioned earlier on. Next up, we're going to feature another pianist of note, Miss Lynn Ariely. I've featured Lynn's music when I put the spotlight on the great pianists of our time. In this case, we're going to go back to Germany. In the year 2005, feature Lynn Ariely, her trio, and they're going to perform a tune entitled Flamenco. Thank you. It should be pretty clear why she entitled that tune Flamenco. You hear literally Spain coming to life before your very eyes and ears. Lynn Ariely, her trio, recorded in 2005 in Germany. The gentleman on the date, Jay Anderson on bass and Steve Davis on drums. So where have we been tonight? We have seen concerts emanating from, seen and heard, from Hollywood, from France, from Switzerland, from Uruguay, from New York City, Germany, Quebec, Canada, Spain. We've been all over the world, folks, tonight. And I hope you've had as much fun as I've been having in our 2.5 hours this evening. So much music, so little time. I want to carry on. And again, our focus is on some of the great female instrumentalists. And no longer can or should you ever say, well, she plays good for a girl or she sounds like a guy. No, we've moved beyond that in the realm of this music. And the bottom line is, can he play or can she play? That's the test. Speaking of the ability to play, again, earlier on in the broadcast, we featured the quartet headed up by Jerry Allen. And included in that quartet, in addition to Terry Lynn Carrington, there was that young phenom, the wonderful Miss Esperanza Spalding on bass and vocals. And for our next selection, we're going to go return to Germany last year. And this is Esperanza Spalding, fresh off of her winning the New Star Grammy Award. This is her band, and it's an augmented band, and they are going to play a tune entitled I Can't Help It. This is the Esperanza Spalding Ensemble 2012.
Because I know that I've tried and I can't deny what I'm feeling. I'm out of it. Your love has got me reading. I don't know what I'm feeling, but I wanna dance, sing, cry. I don't know why, but not a little bit. I don't need that, but I don't get it. Exactly what I was trying to explain, but I couldn't quite grip through the jar and the pen. No, that love makes me feel like I'm going to sing, but I'm happy to be here with you. Bye. so glad I found you. You're an angel in the sky. Thank you.
that lady, Tia Fuller again, ramping up the intensity level, working with electric bassist and vocalist Esperanza Spalding. Just some truly great, great musicians. I'm not going to share with you all the folks on this date, but just know that, of course, Esperanza leading this band on electric bass and vocals. Tia Fuller on alto saxophone, the pianist who's been with Esperanza Spalding off and on for a number of years, Leo Genovese, Lyndon Rochelle on drums, and the ensemble, recorded in Germany just last year. And the tune, I Can't Help It, Miss Esperanza Spalding. She's no longer a rising star, she has risen. She is one of the giants, truly, on either upright bass or electric bass. And of course, she sings pretty well too, I think you'll agree with me. Just a quick note that next week will be our final week of the fall semester 2013. And session 14, to be specific. And our time remains the same. We will hit at 7, leave the air at 10. And again, according, if all goes according to plan, my guests will be longtime colleague, jazz historian Jeffrey Winston. And my hope is that during the broadcast, we will be joined by a very, very special lady who represents a very, very important organization, specifically the California Jazz Foundation. Hopefully Edith Bronston will be able to join us, and we'll talk about that organization and the importance of it and the role it plays in the jazz community. And of course, anytime Jeffrey comes on the program, we have a lot of fun sharing this music, sharing some of the history, and not quite sure what our specific theme will be next week, other than putting the spotlight on the California Jazz Foundation, but you can rest assured we're going to have some special music for you for our final broadcast of the fall semester. Earlier on in the broadcast, I shared the music of Terry Lynn Carrington. Just a few numbers ago, I shared Terry Lynn Carrington with her own Mosaic project. That first clip you saw, she in Jerry Allen's band, they played a ballad. The second time you saw her in performance, they were playing essentially a contemporary medium groove with Terry Lynn Carrington on drums setting the pace. This next clip features Terry Lynn Carrington as part of the Danilo Perez trio. And this goes back a few years. They paid a tribute to one of the great, great iconic drummers of all time, Mr. Roy Haynes. And we're going to put the spotlight on Terry Lynn Carrington once again. And she's going to demonstrate her chops playing just straight ahead, a straight ahead post-bop groove. And you'll hear the other cats in the background initially, but this is essentially a drum clinic put on by Miss Terry Lynn Carrington. The tune, Matrix, the Danilo Perez trio featuring Terry Lynn Carrington on drums.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, Terry Lynn Carrington.
Thank you.
Now that's how you play a set of traps and snares. Truly a drum clinic by, what can you say about Miss Terry Lynn Carrington? The lady can play. The trio, Danilo Perez on piano. Of course, Danilo Perez continues to tour and has for the last 8 or 9 or more years with Wayne Shorter's aggregation. And on bass, Mr. John Lockwood. This was recorded as part of a tribute to the great Roy Haynes. And those of you who are real jazzers out there probably recognize the tune entitled Matrix. The connection there is back in the late 1960s, Chick Corea was still a young, up-and-coming pianist. He'd already worked with any number of great, great jazz musicians back on the East Coast and had a couple of releases to his name, including Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. But in the late 1960s, he released an album entitled Now He Sings, Now He Sobs. And one of the tunes on that date was Matrix, the same tune that you just heard. And who was the drummer on that date? Mr. Roy Haynes. The bassist was Miroslav Vitus. And if you were with me, probably last semester, they resurrected that trio back at the Blue Note in New York City, the Matrix, the Now He Sings, Now He Sobs trio with Miroslav Vitus and Roy Haynes, and the great Chick Corea out front on piano. In this case, they again brought Matrix to life again with Miss Terry Lynn Carrington, showing you how it's done on drums, straight ahead. That's drumming at its finest. We have featured some of the extraordinary female instrumentalists, both present and past. And again, I just want to remind you of the names that we've shared this evening. Looking back to the earlier years, the likes of Valeda Snow, the International Sweethearts of Rhythm, the glorious Miss Mary Lou Williams, and of course those all-female bands, probably the most prominent being the International Sweethearts of Rhythm. And then we threw in some more contemporary artists who continue to make their way in the world of jazz and beyond, including, again, you saw Terry Lynn Carrington, the wonderful drummer, bassist extraordinaire, Esperanza Spalding, the great pianist, Miss Jerry Allen. And going back a few more years, we shared the stylings of the immortals like Vi Redd, alto saxophonist supreme, the trumpetist, Miss Clora Bryant, the wonderful arranger, trombonist, Melba Liston, all of whom have made invaluable contributions to the world of jazz, and they didn't let gender get in their way. They pushed forward, and you heard some of those results this evening over the last not quite 3 hours. I want to wish all of you a happy Thanksgiving. Get together with family. Don't go shopping. Get together with family and recollect what a year it's been through conversation and music, not in the malls. That's just my personal opinion. Enjoy the rest of the week. We are going to close with two ladies of jazz. You talk about jazz royalty. When that iconic photograph was done in 1958, two of the three women included the lady you see over my left shoulder, Miss Marian McPartland, and the wonderful Miss Mary Lou Williams. Here they are in tandem, a tune entitled Scratching in the Gravel from Marian McPartland's first edition of Piano Jazz back in 1978. We'll see you next week. Have a great rest of the week.